Today we're talking about popular church opinion, and maybe you've heard about opinion polls. The first known opinion poll that was ever taken was a straw poll taken in 1824 by the Harrisburg Pennsylvanian, and it predicted accurately that Andrew Jackson would win the presidency over John Quincy Adams, and he would win by approximately 335 votes to 169. Now, that was a very small poll, but it proved out to be true. Jackson won the popular vote in the state of Pennsylvania. He won the popular vote in the whole country, and he won the most important electoral college vote, and he was elected president of the United States. But it wasn't until the year 1916 that a magazine called the Literary Digest conducted what we would call the first nationwide opinion poll. And it did this partly to help raise circulation rates. But it predicted in 1916 that Woodrow Wilson would become the next president of the United States, and you know what? They were correct. And in 1920, they did this again, and they accurately predicted that Warren Harding would be our next president. In 1924, they got it right. They said Cool Calvin, Calvin Coolidge, would be the next president of the United States. In the next election, they got it right again, Herbert Hoover. And in 1932, they correctly, through this means, predicted that Franklin Roosevelt would be the president of the United States. Now, in 1936, a man by the name of Alf Landon was running for president against Roosevelt, who was running for re-election. And Literary Digest, again, took its poll, and it got 2.3 million votes in. And you know what they predicted? They predicted that Alf Landon was going to win in a landslide. Because this magazine was going out mostly to affluent people. And these people tended to be Republicans. And they were all going to vote for Alf Landon, you see. Well, there was another man by the name of George Gallup. Have you ever heard of the Gallup poll? Yeah. And he conducted a very scientific poll, a very much smaller poll, but based upon a larger demographic group of people. And he predicted that instead of Alf Landon winning the election, that Franklin Roosevelt was going to win in a landslide victory. And the fact was, he gained the largest landslide victory, the greatest victory in a presidential election ever at that time. Well, it's interesting, the Literary Digest soon went out of business, but Gallup kept going. And even today, there's what is known as the Gallup poll. It's very well known and very popular. But people are interested. People are interested in what other people think. Because rightfully or wrongfully, they make decisions based upon what other people think. But I want to tell you that the concept and the views held by the majority of the population, or even the church population, which we consider the majority or the popular opinion, is not always right. And in fact, it is seldom right. The Bible, on the other hand, it urges us to have personal, independent thinking based upon God's Word, rather than to the adherent of a popular belief or simply what a preacher says or what a preacher might publish. That's right. And God's people, friends, we should not be concerned about public opinion, or should I say public church opinion. Church opinion. What we need to be concerned about is what does God say? What does the Word of God say? I wanted to share with you a few scriptures, and let's begin by turning to Exodus chapter 23 and verse 2. It says, "But thou shalt not follow a multitude to do what? To do evil." The idea is, friends, that just following a multitude because they are a multitude is wrong. If the multitude is doing right, by all means, get in line. But the facts will show that on this earth, the multitude is almost always wrong. And when we get behind the multitude, we are there to do evil. In Job chapter 31, Job chapter 31, verses 33 and 34 says, "Others try to hide their sins, but I have never concealed mine. I have never feared what people would say. I have never kept quiet or stayed indoors because I feared their scorn." You know, friends, sometimes people wait to see which way the current is moving. Where is the popular opinion? And they get in line with what seems to be popular. And Job, a man of great integrity, one of three men that God could outline through his prophet and say, this was a great man. Though Noah, Daniel, and Job were in the land, remember? And he said, "I never hid myself. I never was quiet because of what people might say or that they might scorn me." In other words, friends, he didn't hold back the truth for anyone or for anything. He wasn't afraid of what people would say. In the Testimonies for the Church, volume 1, page 406, we have these words. "We are not to measure ourselves by the world, nor by the opinions of man, nor by what we were before we embraced the truth. But our faith and position in the world, as they now are, must be compared with what they would have been if our course had been continually onward and upward since we professed to be followers of Christ." Now that, beloved, is our standard. That's where our opinion needs to be. Not on what other people are doing. And of course, the Apostle Paul says it's not wise if we compare ourselves with ourselves, since by doing so we're not wise. We don't want to compare ourselves with others, with where we maybe were even. But where should we be if we had gone onward and upward? That's what we should be concerned about. Brother O.H. Harold, some of you knew Brother Harold. He had an experience one day. He was driving with Brother Glenn Ford, and they went by a church that was just had a full parking lot. It was packed. And Brother Harold made the comment to Brother Glenn. He says, "You can just about be sure of one thing, and that is that they're not preaching the truth in that church." And he could say that based upon the principle, friends, that the majority is usually not right, and the majority usually doesn't want to hear the truth. The majority wants smooth things preached to them. And that's the way it always has been. Now, friends, the majority, as we said, is usually not right. There's exceptions. The majority of heaven is correct, isn't it? And one day we will be part of that family of earth and heaven become one united in substance, and the majority will always be true then. But the majority is usually not right. But let me just say, let me give you a word of caution, and that is, the opposite is, the minority is not always right. Did you get that? The minority is not always right. You could have a church of 100 people and there could be a schism. And 10 people move out here and they look at the 90 over here. And these 10 say, "Well, look, that's the majority. The majority is never right. We are the few standing for God." But then within that 10, there's a few more who say, "Well, but those 8 over there, they can't be right because we differ in this area right here. And so we separate from them and we are the minority, therefore we must be right." And finally, there's a breakup between the two and they each are sure they're right. Yeah, that can happen. It's true. Jesus said, "Fear not, little flock," in Luke 12:32, "for it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom." In Matthew chapter 7, Jesus said that the broad road, the easy way, would be attended by the majority. But the way to heaven was a straight way and a narrow gate through which you went, and few there be that find it. And this is generally the rule of thumb. That the great majority, where the masses are going, is not the truth. Now, public opinion can have quite an effect. And we see this in the Bible. And I wanted to show you a couple places or two. Let's go to 1 Samuel 15. 1 Samuel 15. 1 Samuel 15, we're going to read verses 22 through 24. "And Samuel said, Hath the Lord as great delight in burnt offerings and sacrifices as in obeying the voice of the Lord? Behold, to obey is better than sacrifice, and to hearken than the fat of rams." Do you know what story we're talking about here? Does this ring a bell? Remember, Samuel had commanded Saul to go out and destroy Amalek, to destroy them all. to don't leave even one person behind. Don't even spare their children. Don't spare their cattle or their beasts or their animals. But here comes Saul back with the king. And here comes Saul back with all these great herds. And Samuel meets him and he gives the truth straight and point to him. And he says, "For rebellion is as the sin of witchcraft, and stubbornness is as iniquity and idolatry. Because thou hast rejected the word of the Lord, he hath rejected thee from being king." And Saul said unto Samuel, "I have sinned, for I have transgressed the commandment of the Lord and thy words, because I feared the people and obeyed their voice." He feared the people. The popular opinion of the troops was, we should take these back. And Saul was too much of a coward to say no. He wouldn't stand up for what was right. And one of the few places where the majority was good was a time earlier. Remember that they were fighting again the Philistines, and there was Jonathan and his armor bearer, and all the others were with Saul. And Jonathan went up and they started a great victory. But earlier that day, the king had said, anyone who eats anything this day, he's going to die. We're fasting about this. But Jonathan saw the honeycomb and he said, oh, I'm going to eat some of this and it's good for me. And look how good it's helped me. And when his dad found out, he was going to kill his own son because of it. Because of the pride of his own word. But the multitude stood up and said, no, you won't do this. And so Saul again, he relinquished to the multitude. In other words, he was a man that didn't live by what his principles were. Public opinion led to Jesus Christ being crucified. In Matthew chapter 27, and verse, it says, "And now at that feast the governor was wont to release unto the people a prisoner whom they would. And they had then a notable prisoner called," who? Barabbas. And you remember the rest of the story. You can read it on down through verse 26 there. Here was a vile criminal, someone who was notable for being wicked. And Pilate, in an endeavor to save Jesus, brings out this wicked man and he puts him in stark contrast. He sets him in contradistinction to Christ. And he says, "Would you that I release unto you Jesus or Barabbas?" And what did the popular opinion say? It said, "Give us Barabbas." And Pilate gave in to that. Popular opinion led to Peter being imprisoned in Acts chapter 12 and verse 3. Acts chapter 12 and verse 3. We can read verse 1, 2 to get the context, verses 1, 2, and 3. "Now about that time Herod the king stretched forth his hands to vex certain of the church. And he killed James the brother of John with the sword. And because he saw it pleased the Jews, he proceeded further to take Peter also." It pleased the Jews that James was killed. And so to take Peter. And of course, he knew it pleased the Jews if Peter died. And what do you think would happen then? It pleased the Jews more. And the next one might be John or Andrew or someone else. God says this has got to stop. And he did stop it. Very seldom in public opinion, or in church opinion for that matter, have we ever recorded in a positive way the majority being correct. It's very, very seldom. Public opinion is often contrary to the divine will and to divine standards, friends, because the majority are not converted. The majority are living after the flesh and not after the Spirit. And in chapter 1 and verse 2, "Thus speak the Lord of hosts, saying, the people say the time is not come, the time that the Lord's house should be built. Then came the word of the Lord by Haggai the prophet, saying, is it time for you, O ye, to dwell in your sealed houses, and houses this house lie waste?" And then he tells them to consider their ways, how they've been prospering, they have all these things, and yet my house is lying in wait. This was a terrible thing. And the people, this was the desires of the people. But he goes on to say, but I'm not blessing you in all this. In verse 6, "Ye have sown much and bring in little. Ye eat, but ye have not enough. Ye drink, but ye are not filled with drink. Ye clothe you, but there is none warm. And he that earneth wages, earneth wages to put into a bag with holes." Thus saith the Lord of hosts, consider your ways, go up to the mountain, and bring wood, and build the house, and I will take pleasure in it, and will be glorified, saith the Lord. Ye looked for much, and lo, it came to little. And when ye brought it home, I did blow upon it. Why? Thus saith the Lord, because of mine house that is waste, and ye run every man into his own house. And God was not happy with this situation, and he says he's going to bring a drought upon the land, and things are going to be hard. Now, to the credit of the people, here was a time when they listened. They listened. And they decided they'd do something about it. We have some nice insight on this in the book Prophets and Kings I'd like to share with you. The message of counsel and reproof given through Haggai was taken to heart by the leaders and people of Israel. They felt that God was in earnest with them. They dared not disregard the repeated instructions sent them, that their prosperity, both temporal and spiritual, was dependent on faithful obedience to God's commands. Aroused by the warnings of the prophet, Zerubbabel and Joshua, with all the remnant of the people, obeyed the voice of the Lord their God and the words of Haggai the prophet. Continuing, as soon as Israel decided to obey, the words of reproof were followed by a message of encouragement. Then spake Haggai unto the people, saying, I am with you, saith the Lord. And the Lord stirred up the spirit of Zerubbabel, and of Joshua, and of all the remnant of the people. And they came and did the work in the house of the Lord of hosts, their God. And then she says, in less than a month after the work of the temple was resumed, the builders received another comforting message. Be strong, O Zerubbabel, the Lord himself urged through his prophet. Be strong, O Joshua, and be strong, all ye people of the land, saith the Lord, and work, for I am with you, saith the Lord of hosts. Haggai 2:4. And that's from the book Prophets and Kings, page 575. I want you to remember something, because we're going to come back to this later. When the people listened to the prophet, they prospered and were blessed. When the people listened to the prophet, it was as if the voice of God was speaking to them, because, friends, it is the voice of God, and they heard, and when they heard, they came under, and they obeyed it, and they prospered. Amen. But many times the majority have caused problems, and I won't take time to read all these, but think about when God sent the 12 spies out to spy out the land of Canaan. He sent 12 out. Two came back with a good report. Which two?
Joshua
and Caleb. They came back with a good report. But there were 10. And you know what? I'll bet none of us know the name of one of those 10, but they're all mentioned by name in the Bible. Friends, their names are lost to almost to obscurity, because they brought back an evil, wicked report. And those 10 got the majority of the people going, and they were ready to stone Joshua and Caleb and Moses. Because of this. And because of this rebellion of the majority, they went back to the wilderness and stayed there for 40 years. 1 Samuel chapter 8, starting in verse 4, we'll read verses 4 through 9. Then all the elders of Israel gathered themselves together and came to Samuel unto Ramah, and said unto him, Behold, thou art old, and thy sons walk not in thy ways. Now make us a king to judge us like all the nations. But the thing displeased Samuel. Let me ask you a question. Why did it displease Samuel?
It was rejecting God.
Because it was offending God. They were rejecting God. But the thing displeased Samuel. And when they said, Give us a king to judge us, and Samuel prayed unto the Lord. And the Lord said unto Samuel, Hearken unto the voice of the people in all that they say unto thee, for they have not rejected thee, but they have rejected me, that I should not reign over them. According to all the works which they have done since the days that I brought them up out of Egypt, even unto this day, wherewith they have forsaken me and served other gods, so do they also unto thee. Now therefore, hearken unto their voice, howbeit yet protest solemnly unto them, and show them the manner of the king that shall reign over them. And Samuel sure did that. But this is what the majority wanted. And the majority ruled. And you know, we like to think that we live in something called a democracy today. In the United States, we live in a democracy, and our goal seems to be politically to make sure everybody in the world lives under a democracy. But the fact is, this country was not founded as a democracy. You know that, don't you? It was founded as a republic.
Amen.
And in a republic, the majority don't always have to be right. In a republic, you just want what is right to be had. In a democracy, everybody gets to vote, and it's not always right. In fact, it usually isn't. It usually isn't. In 1 Kings chapter 18, verse 21. 1 Kings chapter 18 and verse 21. The prophet Elijah has gathered Israel at Mount Carmel. And something's got to happen. And Elijah came unto all the people and said, "How long halt ye between two opinions? If the Lord be God, follow him. But if Baal, then follow him." And the people answered him not a word. The people answered him not a word. He says, "How long halt ye between two opinions?" It's taken from a Hebrew metaphor of a bird hopping from one branch to another, seemingly never knowing where it wants to settle. And they were quiet. And even the 7,000 who had not bowed the knee to Baal, either they weren't there or they were quiet, friends. And I often wonder, have we done worse today? Because you know what, friends? We have a lot of people that have ceased being indifferent. They've gotten off the fence. Oh, they've gotten off the fence all right. But they've got off on the wrong side of the fence.
Amen.
They've got on the side of the majority. And that's wrong. And I was just telling the Aikens last night, I said, I think we've done worse than the people in Elijah because we've got off on the wrong side. But then I had to recant my words because we haven't done worse. In volume 3 of the Testimonies on page 280, it says, "If God abhors one sin above another, of which his people are guilty, it is doing nothing in case of an emergency. Indifference and neutrality in a religious crisis is regarded of God as a grievous crime and equal to the very worst type of hostility against God." Do you understand that? That it is actually worse to be neutral than to be on the side of the majority? At least, you know, friends, sometimes when you're on the side of the majority, if the wickedness is clear enough, and bear me out, if the wickedness is clear enough, if the error is pronounced enough, at least we know where you stand and we know it's wrong. If someone's going to be in error, I would rather for them to be in a great error that is plain for others to see instead of a subtle error where the track of truth and track of error lie close beside each other, and to the undiscerning eye that's not worked by the Holy Spirit, it's very difficult to discern which one's right. They may appear as one. It would be better, it would be far better, friends, to be out in left field, as we say. We have that figure of speech here in America, to be out in left field. To be way off than to be neutral or not clear on where you're standing. So maybe we are not as bad as Israel for today. But many are not being quiet about wholeheartedly throwing in their hats with the ringleaders of apostasy. There was a mob in the day of Jeremiah. Jeremiah spoke to the people. You read about in Jeremiah chapter 26. And the people wanted to kill Jeremiah. Unfortunately, some of the princes and some of the elders stepped in and said, "No, you can't do this. This man's speaking for God." But the majority, they were ready to get rid of him. They probably said, "You know, this guy Jeremiah, he speaks bad about us. He speaks bad about us. And he says ill things about us. And he doesn't like us. He's upset with us. He's harboring grudges against us." You think they said that about Jeremiah? I know they must have said that about Jeremiah. But was it the truth? Not at all, friends. Jeremiah loved those people. He was willing to die for those people. He was going to tell them the truth even if it killed him for those people. And all these divisions, friends, that separate the majority from the minority, that separate truth from righteousness, that separate holiness from wickedness, they really ultimately all center around Jesus Christ and what we do with Jesus Christ. Public and church opinion of Jesus Christ has always brought the division. In Matthew chapter 16, I'm sure you've heard this verse. Matthew chapter 16. I suppose in many ways this was the first public opinion poll. Matthew chapter 16. Matthew 16, verse 13. When Jesus came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, "Whom do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?" And they said, "Some say that thou art John the Baptist, some Elias, another Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." And he saith unto them, "But whom say ye that I am?" And Simon Peter answered and said, "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God." You know what? That wasn't the answer that any of the popular opinion polls gave. Not one opinion poll said that this is who the majority believed Jesus to be. And you know what? The same is still true today. Mm-hmm. You take a poll of the majority of church leaders, church representatives, church members today, and Jesus is the second person of a supposedly holy Trinity. But the Apostle Peter said, "Thou art the Son of the living God." And Jesus said in verse 17, "Blessed art thou, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven." We've been told in the book Desire of Ages on page 413 that Peter had expressed the truth which is the foundation of the church's faith. And in fact, on the page before, on page 412, she said Peter expressed the believer's faith, the foundation of the individual believer's faith. But because the church is made up collectively of all the individuals, it has to be the church's faith also, doesn't it? And if it is the foundation of the church's faith, then it must be the foundation of the individual believer, unless that believer is not part of the true church. John chapter 7 and verse 12 says, "And there was much murmuring among the people concerning him," that is Jesus, "for some said, he is a good man, others said, nay, but he deceiveth the people." Well, you know what? It's the same today. There are some that will look at the ministers of Christ today and say, "Oh, they're good people. They're doing a good work." And others will say, "No, they're deceiving the people." And I'm going to tell you what, if you've got different ministers of Christ, different people professing to be ministers of Christ, and they're preaching different gospels, then I'm going to tell you what, there is someone bad in that group, and there may not even necessarily be anyone good. Because just because you have a diverse group of opinions doesn't mean you have the right opinion yet. In Matthew chapter 16, "Whom do the people say that I, the Son of Man, am?" Some say you're John the Baptist, or Elias, or Jeremiah, you know, or one of the prophets. Well, none of those people had the right answer. So again, it's just because you think someone else is wrong over here doesn't make someone else right over here. Everything must be tested by what inspiration has for us. Yes. It's that simple. Sacred history reveals the stand of one, as it were, against many. I think of Noah. What do you suppose it was like to be Noah? Can you imagine what it was like building for 120 years that ark? And he was a laughingstock, exactly. But I suppose of all the great sermons that have ever been preached, of all the great appeal sermons that have ever been preached, that last sermon that Noah preached might have been one of the greatest ever. I'd love to have heard it, wouldn't you? Can you imagine? Here he is. He knows that that door is going to be shut. He knows that the rain is coming. And he knows that everyone is outside that ark will be lost. And he's appealing and he's pleading and he's begging and he's crying for the people to come in, and they won't come in. But against all the popular opinion of a whole world, Noah went into that ark. I think even the leading scientists of the day must have declared that water just couldn't hang in the sky and then drop down at the will of God. Everyone was against him. We read about Elijah. Elijah was against the opinion of the church. He was against the opinion of the government. And even if there were 7,000 who had not bowed the knee to Baal, and there were, because God says there were, they weren't vocal at Mount Carmel. He stood, in effect, as being alone. What about Moses when he came down from the mount with the table of stone? Remember? And here his own brother, the high priest, who had just been anointed of God as the high priest of Israel, was leading all of Israel into this golden calf apostasy. And Moses stood, as it were, alone. And he stood boldly. He stood with confidence. Boldly. He had the assurance that he was in the majority. Because, friends, if you stand with God, if it's just you alone standing with God, you stand in the majority.
That's right.
Because God and you make a majority, and that's all you need. That is the real majority. That's the true majority. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, they were told to bow down to the image. Everybody else did. And in fact, it wasn't just the people of Babylon alone, because when you read the story, friends, it says that Nebuchadnezzar, he called all the captains and rulers from all the provinces. And I can just assure you that the king of Judah was there as well. And he bowed down. But these men would not bow down. And of course, the supreme example of one person standing when all else fled was in the Garden of Gethsemane, when Jesus Christ stood true and tall, despite having perspiration of blood upon his face and all of his disciples forsaking him. He stood against the opinion of the world, and he was faithful unto the end. Now, we've been talking about the opinion of the majority, but we need to include also in this and understand the opinion of the individual. Because sometimes, friends, the opinion of an individual can bring about a rising of a people and can sway a majority. One person with the wrong idea, friends, can do havoc. There was a man by the name of Karl Marx. You recognize that name? Mm-hmm. The father of what's called Marxism, or later became known as communism. And there was a man by the name of Lenin who got a hold of this idea. Yeah. And it enslaved millions of people for almost a century. And some of those people are still enslaved, just in a different way. In Selected Messages, Book 1, on page 72, we have been told that self-will and pride of opinion lead many to reject the light from heaven. They cling to pet ideas, fanciful interpretations of Scripture, and dangerous heresies. And if a testimony is born to correct these errors, they will, like many in Christ's day, go away displeased. Think about it for just a minute. Let that soak in, what it's saying. They have pet ideas. We may all have pet ideas about some things, and maybe that's okay on some things, but friends, not on things of Scripture. They have fanciful interpretations of Scripture. That means they have interpretations that are just crazy. Dangerous heresies. And I don't know that there's any kind of a heresy. It's not dangerous.
That's right.
There's an emphasis here. It's dangerous. And when the testimony comes, they're displeased. And so you know what they do? They ignore the testimony. They ignore the testimony. They say, well, this testimony, it's let me down. I don't need it. I'll just go with something that I like. I like the Bible because I can interpret it any way I want. I can put my fanciful interpretations to it. Friends, one reason I hate to see false views go into print, or one reason I hate to see false views preached, is that they are seldom retracted once they become public. It's one thing, friends, if you come up with an idea and you're not sure if it's sound or not, and you present it before the brethren of experience, and you can sit down and talk about it together, and maybe the brethren of experience can show you that this is not sound. And therefore, it's easy to step back and say, you know, I love my brethren. I love the Word of God, and they have helped me to understand that I have a wrong interpretation on it. My interpretation was a fanciful interpretation, but they have given me the correct understanding of this, and that's what I want. And so you can back down from that. But once you put something into print and it goes to thousands of people, or maybe you stand up and speak and hundreds hear you and then they get the videotapes or they see it on YouTube. Friends, it becomes very, very hard to back down and say, I was wrong. I was wrong. People don't usually do it. It takes courage to do that. We had a young man who was in this area several years ago, and he had learned this, what we call new theology at Southern College. It used to be called Southern Missionary College, now it's Southern University. And he was just preaching it as loud and hard as he could. But you know what? He learned the truth. He learned the truth. And the very first Sabbath he had a chance to preach after he learned the truth, he stood in the pulpit and he said, "I got to tell you folks that I've been telling you errors and lies. And I want to show you why I've done this, what the lies were, and what the real truth on these matters and issues are." I can appreciate that. You know, we don't probably as a group of people have a very, very favorable impression or mindset toward Donald Barnhouse and Walter Martin. Remember who they were? Donald Barnhouse and Walter Martin. But you know, Donald Barnhouse published a magazine called Eternity Magazine. And he had called Seventh-day Adventists not Christians. He said they belonged to a cult. They were sectish people. He'd done this for years. And Walter Martin came along and said, "I'm not so sure about that. I have too, but I've been researching these people. I've been talking to them, and I think maybe they're not a sect at all, like you thought they were. Maybe they're not a heretical group." And in their minds, based upon what our men had told them, we were no longer a heretical group because we had changed. We had made changes. And so these men had the moral courage to publish this in their magazine, Eternity Magazine. And Barnhouse lost thousands of subscriptions over it. Cancellations and failures to renew. In fact, they lost a full third of their subscriptions. A third of them, can you imagine? Because they were willing to stand up for what they believed was right. Oh, friends, how could we let someone like Martin and Barnhouse outdo us? Surely, if they had the moral courage to do that, we will have the moral courage, friends, if we are standing alone to do it and to not give in. Now, if I've preached to you something that's error, and you can show me that it's error, clearly from the Scriptures, I want to change, friends, because all I want is truth. I don't want my opinions. But it's natural. It is natural if we really don't have Christ abiding in our heart to hold on to our opinions, regardless of what we say about Christ. We may say Christ is in my heart. We may say that I'm preaching the righteousness of Christ. And most everyone does. How many people tell you they're preaching the righteousness of Satan or they're preaching righteousness by works? When was the last time you heard a good sermon on that? You see Faith Baptist Church, Faith Methodist Church. When was the last time you saw one that said disobedience? Baptist Church. You know, doesn't happen. But I think of this next statement, and it's one of the most solemn statements in all the Spirit of Prophecy. In Volume 7 of the Testimonies, on pages 191 and 200, we read this. "With sin that is most nearly hopeless and incurable is pride of opinion, self-conceit." The sin that is almost incurable is pride of opinion. It's nearly hopeless. I'm glad she said nearly hopeless. Because, friends, it can be overcome if we will let Jesus in. But this should tell us something about how important it is to say the truth and to know what we say. You know, Jesus, when he was speaking to Nicodemus, he said, "We speak that which is truth." We don't speak our own opinions. Jesus says, "I didn't come to speak my opinion. I came to tell you the words of the Father that He has given me." And the truth is, friends, I'm not wise enough to come up with good interpretations or probably even fanciful interpretations very often. I have to depend upon the Word of God. I have to depend upon the testimonies that God has given His people to know how to interpret His Word. Now we have to come to the hard part. But I want to remind you that when Elijah stood on Mount Carmel and he said, "How long halt ye between two opinions?" That wasn't easy. That was a hard thing he had to do. And then, when it was over, he took those prophets of Baal down to the brook and he slew every one of them. That was hard to do. And we might say, Elijah didn't love those people. Elijah was mean. He was cruel. He wasn't Christ-centered. Elijah was a person without the righteousness of Christ. He didn't have that sweet love, joy, peace in his life. Could we say that about Elijah? Or was Elijah doing the will of God? Amen. May I remind you, friends, Elijah was translated into heaven, and he is in the sweet by and by today. And we carry an Elijah message, friends. And it is to denounce Baal worship, the worship of that which is false, the worship of that which leads people into disobedience against God's commandments. And we must do that if we want to be translated. I recently received a magazine in the mail. And this magazine, which by the way had a couple articles that were co-authored by a Romanian brother that I love very dearly. This magazine had an article entitled The Mystery of Iniquity. But this article was written, I do not believe, to clarify anything about the mystery of iniquity, but rather to confuse. It used confusing terms. It spoke about the law, the law, the law in several places. And sometimes it was clear that it was speaking the ceremonial law. Sometimes it seemed to be implying it was speaking the Ten Commandment law. And very seldom was it ever clarified exactly what law it was speaking about. There were several suppositions given as foundation upon which other ideas were based. The tenor of the article was that the Apostle James and the decree from the Council of Jerusalem, as recorded in Acts chapter 15, was the beginning of the formation of the mystery of iniquity that Paul spoke about in Thessalonians. Did you get that? Let me say that again. The tenor of this article is in two parts, part one, part two. But the tenor of the article, the synopsis was that the Apostle James and the decrees from the Council of Jerusalem formed the beginning of the mystery of iniquity. Because it was laying a foundation of not faith in Christ, but righteousness by works. Let me just quote to you from this paper. Here it is. James understood that the issue was threatening to divide the Christian church, and he proposed a compromise solution. The author or authors of this article say that what James declared as recorded in the Holy Word of God in Acts chapter 15 was a compromise solution. He later says it was based on a legalistic approach to righteousness. Now, that's an interpretation. And I could tell you what I think about it. But you know what? It would just maybe be my interpretation. And I'd rather not give you my interpretation because I don't trust my interpretation. But I will give you what the Spirit of Prophecy says. Now, if you believe the Spirit of Prophecy, if you're like those people that don't like the Spirit of Prophecy or have believe it's failed you or believe it's in error, then this maybe won't mean anything more to you than if I give you my interpretation. But for those of you who still value the testimony of Jesus and still believe it's the Spirit of Prophecy, here's what we read there. I have one more quote I have to read to give you the full benefit of this, and then we'll come back to what the Spirit of Prophecy says. After quoting Acts 15, 23 through 29, which is the letter that was sent out by the Jerusalem Council to the brethren in the different places, here's what's written in that article. It says this: notice that this epistle is lacking any instruction to not depart from Christ and to hold fast to him by faith. It contains only the four commandments proposed by James. It is not hard to imagine what may have happened in the minds of the Gentile Christians who read it. Their attention was diverted from Jesus to the fulfillment of the four rules with the promise that if ye abstain, ye shall do well. A new path opened for the Gentile Christians, not the way of the law from Sinai, but the law from Jerusalem. But the principle promoted was actually the same. Be careful what you do, and you will be saved. If you do not break the rules, you will be a true Christian. Now, before discussing again what the Spirit of Prophecy says about this council and this letter and other things, let me just remind you something that's found in the book of Galatians chapter 5. Galatians chapter 5. Galatians chapter 5 speaks about the fruit of the Spirit, doesn't it? But it also speaks about something called the works of the flesh. And in verse 19 he says, now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies. Did you get that?
Amen.
Heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like, of the which I tell you before, as I have also told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Friends, notwithstanding any profession they make about Jesus Christ. It is true, friends, that by grace are you saved through faith. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Our works will never save us. But I want to tell you, the Apostle Paul, the man who we talk so much about, the author of faith, teaching of faith, he makes it very clear here that our works, if they're bad works, if they are wicked works, friends, they will cause us to be lost. And don't you ever forget that. Only grace through faith can save us, but friends, but works can cause us to be lost, irrespective of our claim of faith. Now, who was behind this so-called letter that they're commenting on here in Acts 15, 23 through 29? The apostles, it says the elders and brethren, Paul and Barnabas, Judas and Silas were especially mentioned as those carrying the letter. Someone says James compromised in that council, but I do not believe it, and neither do I believe that Paul compromised in carrying that letter. If that letter was so bad, then why was Paul a courier for that letter? Why did Paul promote that letter if it was teaching contrary to what Paul said? Because I don't believe Paul was trying to compromise then. Now, the servant of the Lord has said this. The four servants of God were sent to Antioch with the epistle and message that was to put an end to all controversy, for it was the voice of the highest authority upon the earth. Did you get that? As Paul and Barnabas and Silas and Judas took this epistle to Antioch, it was to silence all discussion because it came from the highest authority on earth. In Acts 15 and verse 28, it says, "For it seemed good to the Holy Ghost, or the Holy Spirit, and to us to lay upon you no greater burden than these necessary things." They said these things are necessary. Friends, there are things that are necessary for our Christian lives, and we shouldn't be afraid of them. Because God is good, and He doesn't want us involved in sin. He doesn't want us involved in the bad, wretched things. He doesn't want us involved in pollution and uncleanness. These are necessary things. But it says here, it seemed good to us and to the Holy Ghost also. Well, you know what? If it was good to the Holy Ghost, I don't even know what we should even be worried about for ourselves. It better be good to us because it's good to the Holy Ghost. And that's enough. And I don't see that commented upon here. But continuing in the book Acts of the Apostles on page 194, it says, James also bore his testimony with decision, declaring that it was God's purpose to bestow upon the Gentiles the same privileges and blessings that had been granted to the Jews. The Holy Spirit saw good not to impose the ceremonial law on the Gentile converts, and the mind of the apostles regarding this matter was as the mind of the Spirit of God. Now, friends, do you think God compromised on the issue?
No.
I don't think God compromised a bit on the issue. On page 195, in this instance, James seems to have been chosen as the one to announce the decision arrived at by the council. Was this simply James's decision alone? No, it was a decision of the whole council, friends. The council came together and they brought this before the others. Throughout this study that I'm speaking of in question, James's character is assassinated and the truths of the spirit of prophecy are totally disregarded. And I believe it is equivalent to an open declaration of independence from any body that truly claims to be Seventh-day Adventist. It is tantamount to declaring a declaration of independence from the testimonies and that which our people have stood for all this time. And here's why I say that. In Volume 5 of the Testimonies, on page 534, one point will have to be guarded, and that is individual independence. As soldiers in Christ's army, there should be concert of action in the various departments of the work. No one has the right to start out on his own responsibility and advance ideas in our papers on Bible doctrines when it is known that others among us hold different opinions on the subject and that it will create controversy. Now, there are two qualifiers here. Two qualifiers. And that these things that would be published would be different from opinions held by others and create controversy. We may always have slight differences that we express at times, but we don't do this when it brings it to the point of creating controversy. That's when we come together with the brethren, friends. And if we cannot, after we do that, in good conscience, be quiet, then it is time to declare our independence and that we are no longer part of that body. Let's just be honest. We no longer are Seventh-day Adventists at that point. Let's go somewhere else, start another church if that's what you want to do. But be honest and open about it. Don't claim you're continuing the truth. Don't claim you're upholding the banner of the commandments of God and the faith of Jesus if you're not going to do that. And I told you earlier, and I tell you this sadly, that sometimes it's better. Sometimes it's better if we're going to be in apostasy, to be so deeply in apostasy that at least people can see it and understand it. And I thought I had saw things that were bad before this. And this is only part of the study. This is only the main tenor of the study of what it's about. There are so many details that work to sweep away the foundation of not only true righteousness, but the commandments of God with the faith of Jesus. And I just hope, friends, I just hope and I pray that like the people in the day of Haggai, that there will be people who have bought into this program, that will read what the testimony, what the Spirit of God, what the prophet has said to his people, and they will change like the people in Haggai's day. They won't have so much pride of opinion that they can't say, you know what, we've went off and we've done our own thing. That's what the people did in Haggai's time. They went off and built their own houses, took care of their own selves, they were doing their own thing. Today we're simply doing it theologically instead. We're doing our own thing theologically. But friends, it's time to stop. And if this train that we've been on since 1844 is wrong, then friends, let's just be honest, let's just chuck it, let's get rid of it, and let's just denounce the whole thing, because I'm going to tell you that's what's going to happen, and it's going to happen for a surety if you step off on these kind of vital points. It's just a matter of when and where it happens. It's going to happen. I've seen it over and over and over, and it's been prophesied in the testimonies that would happen, and we've seen it fulfilled.
That's right.
But friends, we have not followed cunningly devised fables. The truth is still the truth, and all the hellish lies of Satan cannot change one truth into 100 errors.
Amen.
I appeal to you today, friends, to believe in true Bible individuality that allows you to think for yourself, but that brings you into a true unity with the brethren, a unity of truth. God has given us, as a people, truth, friends, and this is not the day to go to a new paradigm of thought. Today is the day to stay on truth and to hold truth, and if we've left that truth, to come back to that truth. And I want you to come back right early, because the Lord wants you back and He loves you, and just like as in the day of Haggai, He'll take you back and He'll prosper your work and He'll bless your work. May God add His blessing to this service, and may God bless Israel today.